division of the Ministry of External Affairs with us. So I welcome Dr. Kamal Vishnu to the webinar.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Good to be part of the discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Kamal. So as I said earlier, now I request Dr. Suraj to just briefly speak about the activities at our center, following which we'll have Dr. Mandal's presentation.
Yeah, thanks, Shyam, for the introduction. And I'll just take a few minutes of the time to just briefly go over the center and why we have been conducting these webinars. So I'll just share my screen. Okay, can you see the screen? Shyam, is it visible?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Okay. So as Shyam mentioned, I'm a senior research associate at the Center for Predictive Human Model Systems at Atal Incubation Center, CCMB. And this center was established almost 2 years back now as a policy and a think tank center to enable methodologies that are more relevant to human biology. And this center was established in collaboration with Atal Incubation Center and Humane Society International India. So just to kind of go over why the center was established. So my laptop has gotten hung. Okay, yeah. So as you might all know that biomedical research primarily has relied on animal models for several decades. And while animal models have given us extremely useful insights over past several decades, it's also increasingly emerging that they cannot capture the various subtleties of human biology. And this is also evident, for example, we've all in the scenario of COVID, for example, we've all seen that there is a huge heterogeneity in how different human populations respond to a human disease, and also in terms of the response to various drugs. So there is a need which is being felt globally that we need to create and work on model systems that are based on human cells and human biology. And for the past almost a decade, several such methodologies have been developed globally. For example, organoids, organon chips, 3D engineered tissues, etc. And these model systems, as they are based on human cells, they can capture the idea, the aim is that they can capture the subtleties of human biology and how we respond to various drugs. And towards the idea of enabling these methodologies in India, the work of a center has been primarily divided into four broad areas. The first area is we've been working you might know that the awareness for these new methodologies is currently lacking, not just in India, but also globally. So we have been basically working on various popular articles. This webinar is another such example. And these articles have been published, for example, in popular online media outlets and also national newspapers. We also conduct several educational and training programs, and recently our center has also been awarded an EMBO India lecture course, and the details for which we'll be coming out soon with. And apart from these, we are also involved in various policy initiatives. We have worked on three white papers regarding what are the infrastructural and technical limitations in terms of enabling these methodologies in India, and these papers will be coming out soon. We also regularly conduct several multi-stakeholder roundtable meetings. For example, in December, we conducted a meeting with stakeholders from academia, industry, and private funding bodies to again provide recommendations to government bodies in terms of how we can tackle various challenges. We're also involved in several global collaborations, such as a European Commission, also towards this aim of enabling these methods in India. And we are also involved in various funding initiatives. And recently, our center has provided a grant to two Indian scientists to develop an adverse outcome pathway in the field of cancer. And I'd just like to end this presentation on the note that what kind of aims we would like to hope to achieve in the next 5 years or so. So the goals towards which we are working are basically the ideas to establish several centers of excellence to further develop and validate these methods. We'd also like to enable connections between the technology developers in academia and the end users in pharma, for example, in pharma companies. We would also like to engage with various regulatory bodies, because as it is being felt even globally, for example, that engagement with regulatory bodies from the initial stages of technology development is also kind of eases the path of regulatory approval later on. And we are also working towards enabling cross-border collaboration for both technology transfer and funding. And another issue which has emerged in our various discussions is that currently there is a lack of various reagents and infrastructure to develop this technology indigenously in India. So we'd also like to enable strategies which would ease the supply chain for indigenous development of this methodology. So with this short brief about what we are doing and why we are doing, I would just like to end this presentation. And if to know more about our center and our initiatives, you can go to our website. And with this, I would end, and I would ask Shyam to introduce our speaker for this month's webinar. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Suraj, for the brief intro about the center. So now we'll move on. So now I'd like to introduce Dr. Biman Mandal, the speakers for today's webinar. So he'll be the topic for today's webinar is 3D in vitro models for osteochondrial drug screening. So before we start, just a quick intro about Dr. Mandal. Dr. Mandal has done his PhD from IIT Kharagpur, and following which he was a postdoctoral research associate at the Department of Biomedical Engineering at Tufts University, Boston. Following which, he joined IIT Guwahati as an assistant professor, and currently he's the professor at the Biosciences and Bioengineering Department, IIT Guwahati. Apart from it, Dr. Mandal is also a Swarna Jayanti Fellow and a National Bioscience Awardee of DST. And to give a brief intro of his work, so his lab is majorly interested in biomaterials and tissue engineering, 3D bioprinting of human tissues and organs, human stem cell based regeneration technologies, targeted drug delivery systems, and 3D disease models for high throughput drug screening. So having said this, I would now request Dr. Mandal to begin his presentation. Over to you, Dr. Mandal.
Very good morning to everyone. Please confirm if I am audible.
Yes, Dr. Mandal, you are audible.
Okay, you can
share your screen and begin.
First of all, I'm very excited to be part of this initiative, as was already introduced by Surat, that this is something which is probably, you know, is this the future of you know, the drug testing, not only drug testing, the how we would understand disease and how molecules would be, you know, invented against those diseases for human healthcare. So I'm really excited to be part of this, and I thank the organizers for having me here, and thanks for the kind introduction, Shyam. So first let me share the slides, right? Please confirm once it appears.
Yes, Dr. Mandal, you can see your screen.
Okay, so you can see it, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So as was said, today's topic, I'm going to talk about a particular disease model which we have been working on, is the osteochondral model. And primarily the goal was to have a platform which can be used for the drug screening, right? And of course, these are alternative to animal models, and there are a lot of benefits and to that which I would come to it, you know, when I go through the slides, where I'll briefly discuss about how, what is the motto of this, how the design parameters and the disease induction, and finally how we have validated in terms of testing the drugs, so as to assure the audience that these are alternative, actual alternative models, which can be very, very precise, and also give away with the animal models probably, which would not only be, you know, humane, but also probably would be more realistic for the future. I'm facing some issue here. Yes. So before I go into my topic of today's talk, just a brief about what we do at IIT Guwahati that already been introduced.
Dr. Mandal,
yes. Sorry for interruption. If you could go full screen, I think that would be better in the ease of viewing. Yeah.
Yes. Is it now full screen?
Yes. Yes, Dr. Mandal, you can continue.
Yes. So we, as was introduced as well, so we are primarily working on various aspects of tissue regeneration, tissue engineering, where we try to develop different kind of organs and tissues for human interventions primarily, because these tissues are very much needed in terms of leading a healthy life. And mostly we rely on donors, and we all know the number of donors are very, very less, minuscule. In fact, you know, compared to the people who need these kind of organs or tissues to have lead a healthy life. So we work on different aspects, different types of tissues where, you know, some of them are listed here. For example, the blood vessels, the bone, cartilage, skin, intervertebral disc, pancreas, cardiac patches. And also one of our primary aim here is also on drug delivery and 3D disease model. So sorry. One minute. Slides are not moving.
So you can go to the left-hand side below and click the arrow mark.
Yeah, I'm doing that. Yes. So actually there was a delay, I think. Yeah, now it's working. Is the next slide visible on your screen?
Yes, Dr. Mandal.
Yes. So sorry for the interruption. So we do all of this science using a very interesting polymer, which is silk. And primarily we focus on this polymer because of its various advantages. And however, we are known to silk, you know, as a textile material. But seldom we know that this textile material can be very usefully, you know, be very useful in a science called biomaterial, in the form of biomaterials for tissue engineering applications. And as I said, we focus on silk, and primarily wild silk, which is Indian endemic silk, which is relatively unknown. And the reason for me being and settled in Assam is because this is a land of silk, and we have these nice normalberry varieties like the Assama and the Eri, which were unexplored, and we are doing our bit to contribute to the emergence of these new biomaterials for these tissue engineering applications. They have a tons of advantages over the conventional. Of course, we have various options with us when we do tissue engineering or in vitro disease modeling, where we can use synthetic polymers, we can use natural polymers. But in this case, this is a natural polymer, and it has been known to be compatible and not degradable and easy to process, and of course, very, very inexpensive. And that is what is the reason for us to use this. And primarily the wild silk what we use has a very interesting sequence, which is the RGD motif, which allows it to, the cells to bind. That means it allows natural cell binding, more faster proliferation of the tissues or development of these tissues that we are working with. Now, coming to today's topic, which is about the in vitro disease model. Please bear with me for the time lag. I think there's some issues with the network, maybe. That's why it's...
Or maybe you could stop sharing and then again try resharing. Maybe that might help solve.
Will it? Let me try.
Yeah. Oh, we can see your screen, Dr. Mandal.
Yeah. So, sorry, I don't know. This is something new that is happening here. But anyway, So moving on, coming back to today's topic, which is about the development of a 3D printed osteoarthritic in vitro biomimetic model. So primarily the reason for doing this is about understanding this particular disease. Now, as we all know, this is something traditionally considered to be a wear and tear disease where there is degeneration of the musculoskeletal tissues where, you know, there is no cure as such, and surgical interventions are available and joint replacement therapies are commonly performed, right? So what was the motive was to, can we have or aid in drug development which would allow more molecules to be coming to the market, which can primarily be used to treat this particular disease. So now primarily this cartilage driven osteoarthritic is a very complex kind of a condition where a lot of crosstalks happen between the joint tissues, cartilage, subchondral bone and the synovium. So having multiple parameters playing a role, it is very important to recapitulate this within the disease model. And that was our intention here as well. Now there has been a lot of evidence which has shown that, you know, inflammation plays a big role in development or progression of this particular OA disease. And we thought of, you know, mimicking this particular phenotype so that we can test anti-inflammatory drugs and more molecules can be developed with this. Now, this studies mimicking OA conditions proved to be, you know, very, very essential and an opportunity to investigate this inflamed base disease phenotype interventions for osteoarthritic therapeutics development. Now, currently, literature says that there are no such 3D in vitro disease models. Now, whatever is available with us are primarily spheroid-based or cells where people have either used single or multiple cells together, and they have been either testing as in the in vitro model. But again, we all understand this primarily is not the best way to do it because the hierarchical structure, a recapitulation of the tissue is very important because drug effects are prolonged or nullified if this recapitulation of the tissue is not properly done. So our thought process was, can we recapitulate the structure or the hierarchical organization in terms of the bone, cartilage and the interface so that this tissue can be recapitulated. So to address this, we created this particular tissue model where first this osteochondral tissue was created and then it was induced to be a disease state, and further we tested on the molecules. Now, we also know that this particular osteoarthritic condition in the knees, there are different stages to be divided to stage 1, 2, 3, and 4, where stage 1 constitutes the called the minor condition where there are spurs on the bones and minor wear and tear conditions of the cartilage, and it can be treated with supplements, some of the supplements like, you know, glucosamine molecules or chondroitin. However, for stage 2, which is treated as mild condition, this further enhances, leads to increasing wear and tear of this cartilage, and there is irritation and pain in the joint, and that is what is the condition in this mild condition. And there is a lot of breakdown of this cartilage matrix, and that leads to further inflammation. Now in stage 3, we have this moderate condition where erosion of the cartilage surface with narrowing gap between the long end of the long bones happens, and this leads to further broken particles of the collagen and proteoglycan fragments, and which comes into the synovial fluid and leads to further progression of the disease. In stage 4, which is marked as the severe condition, where the space between the long bones and the joint is further reduced, leading to rubbing against each other, leading to stiffening of the joints and a painful experience by people who have this stage 4 severe condition. Now, having said this, the reason for this was to make and clearly state that, you know, a disease model needs to be very, very specific. A disease model here, like if we say that osteoarthritic, one type of disease model is not going to address all these four stages. So what the reason for me to explain that is Now, when we are delving into a disease model, we have to understand the stages. If there are multi-stage related disease model, it is very important to address each of those stages so as to recapitulate the pathophysiology in the design parameters and the conditions so that drugs can be effectively tested. Now, in this condition, we created, as I said, the inflammatory pathway. So it is an early stage osteoarthritic disease model that is been created here. Now, coming to the concept where we are, we have been discussing in the beginning as well, that we have currently in vivo models, which is a gold standard, where animals are injected with molecules to create the disease, and then drug molecules are tested in them. And that is what is done. Now, in the process, it is, of course, it's a, not a human process, which involves killing of animals, and also has a lot of disadvantages because these animals do not recapitulate our pathophysiology, our mimetic condition, right? And also the lifetime of these animals or the life cycle is shorter than the humans. So, of course, we can understand there would be a lot, tons of differences between this disease phenotype, what is created, then what we experience in humans. Now, that probably is an opportunity to create these in vitro models using different modes and different conditions, where 3D fabrication has come up a long way to create these three-dimensional structures, because it gives an advantage of creating a hierarchical order structures precisely in the same hierarchical order, and down to micron range with cells, as in bioprinting, right? And then it can be matured using dynamic cultures, and then one can kind of have thousands of these made in replicas, because this is a very very scalable process, and that is the biggest advantage here. So, so taking this forward, the major advantage, as I said, would be to create this in a human way, to create this more appropriately using human cells, more appropriately using the structures and the phenotype, cellular phenotype, and it would be more of a sustainable and affordable. That is very important, because at the end of the day, that has been a major limitations where animal testing, though being inhuman, has been not affordable. Also, it also associated with lot of clearances and other paperwork that needs for the process to be done. So, what is the outcome of that? It delays process. It makes the process expensive, and finally leading to a long wait for a molecule to be tested, and adding to the cost. So all this can be taken care of by creating these in vitro models, which would not only be affordable, but also would be probably affecting the final price of the molecules that is coming to the market. Now, to take forward our study, we majorly had two main aims. First one was to establish an inflamed osteochondral unit to mimic the early stage osteoarthritis disease phenotype, as I said already. And second was to validate the model as a drug testing platform. So in that, we use two conventional molecules, which are primarily used as a standard molecule for this early stage disease reversal, and see how our model is doing in terms of the phenotypic expression and reversal of the cellular phenotype. Now, in these steps, what we used was we used adipose-derived mesenchymal stem cells, and they were differentiated towards chondrocytes and the osteoblasts, primarily because this osteochondral tissue has both the phenotype of the cartilage and the bone cells. And this further, these cells were primed, MSCs were primed using specific media conditions, and they were embedded in bio-ink. Now, this bio-ink is nothing but the polymer composition which we developed here to 3D print. Now, in a 3D bioprinter, we need to create a polymer which would be amenable to carry these cells and be printable, and allow the cells to live during the printing time and allow them to grow and proliferate when they are grown and matured. So that is the role of a bioink. We developed that, and we created a triphasic osteochondral construct using the 3D printing technique. Further, they were matured for 7 days. And then further to that, what we did was we induced osteoarthritic induction disease through IL-1 beta and TNF alpha molecules, which are pro-inflammatory cytokines. And this is has been available in literature, and we resorted to literature to creating this particular phenotype using these two molecules, which is well known. Further, then we looked at reversal of this disease and through two molecules, which is celecoxib and rhein, and which are established as anti-inflammatory drugs. So we wanted to, as I said, we wanted to see after the drug induction is done and disease model is created by treating these molecules either alone or in combination, whether we see a reversal and what kind of changes we observed in the genetic, in the gene level, protein level expressions. That was our goal. And finally, we investigated the relevant pathways and to understand how these molecules are activated in terms of the MAP kinase and the NF-kappa-B signaling, and because they are primarily involved in the inflammatory cascade. So this was the overall goal here, which I have tried to present in the scheme. Now, taking forward, what we did was, as I said, BioInk is something which is very, very important when it comes to 3D printing of a model. So in this case, the bioprinting was done using the BioInk, and we use, as I said, our lab works on silk. So this BioInk is created specifically using a silk-based polymer, where you use two types of silk, Bombyx mori and Anthria asama, which are mulberry and non-mulberry, the domesticated and the wild variety in certain composition. And we use some bulking agent and some molecules to recapitulate the bone phase in terms of adding hydroxypeptide. And we use some cross-linkers in the form of HRP, which is horseradish peroxidase, because these cross-linkers help in cross-linking of this polymer so that it remains in the viable printed structure and doesn't coalesce, and the structure doesn't get destroyed. And after this, of course, during printing, the cells were, two types of cells were added to this, and they were printed, and the primed cells particularly, and they were then incubated at 37 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. And this particular model was then grown in the incubator. Of course, for building the structure, we resorted to 3D Builder software program. And of course, this is a conventional way of creating G codes, and the dimensions were chosen so that it is a structure which has the capability of allowing nutrient exchanges to happen so that the cell survival remains. Also, the triphasic structure, where the chondrogenic region and the osteogenic region and the interface regions are maintained, and making sure they are printed in an amenable temperature so that cellular viability is retained. Now, while doing this, as is shown in this particular picture, where the cartilaging and the bone ink were done, and the interface and the two other phases were created in the osteoarthritic model. So, this BioInk, we have to understand a certain parameters which are very much essential for this BioInk to exhibit. One of them is the quick thixotropic recovery, aiding in the self-standing structure. So I'm not going into the details, but we looked into that and we found these have exhibit that, allowing the structures to remain and not coalescing and collapsing. Then this particular structure, as I said, had this grid structure, which allows good permeability, enabling the self-assembling of this polymer and recapitulating this osteochondral structure and allowing nutrient exchange to happen. So with these studies being done, of course, we took us a long time to have a, I'm not going into those details, it's an effort of 2+ years where we try to come to a ideal composition which would allow ideal ratios of these molecules so that cells can survive and proliferate, because that is very essential so that the disease induction can be as close as possible to the native disease condition. Now, looking into the molecular aspects here and the disease induction aspects, as I said, Report suggests that inflammation plays a pivotal role, as already expressed, for progression of osteoarthritis. And this has been extensively looked at, where TNF-alpha and 1-beta, IL-1-beta are well-known pro-inflammatory cytokines, which has been reported that play a very crucial role on the onset of this and progression of this particular disease. Now, to look into this, we kind of use these molecules and the synergistic effect of the cytokines and their role in particular in this osteoarthritic, encourage the induction of this particular disease in a osteoarthritic-like condition. Now here we used two of these molecules, as I said. So Rhine and celecoxib are the two commercially available molecules which are tested and which have been commercially used and as a gold standard. And this particularly are inhibitors of the COX-2, this celecoxib, and Rhine particularly is inhibiting the action of the effect of IL-1-beta. So this is the reason we have used these two, because earlier to induce this disease condition, we use this particular cytokines, and we wanted to see the effect of these inhibitors. And once these inhibitors act on this particular disease phenotype, we wanted to see a reversal. And that is exactly the reason for using these two. Thus, we use these two well-studied anti-inflammatory drugs for validation of our in vitro model. And we validated them with the experiments that we conducted. Now here is a gross structure of the construct which is used for creating of this osteoarthritic disease model and disease creation, and also the drug testing. Now it has been done to keeping in mind multiple parameters, as I already explained, where we wanted to create an ambient environment for the cells to survive, grow. And also we wanted nutrient exchange to happen, because we tissue engineers have felt and realized over time that smaller structures are viable. But if you're looking at disease progression, which is over the time of 7, 14 and 21 days, and it's a long time for the culture conditions to remain viable, we have to look at the design parameters. And considering all those parameters, where cell survival was the prime key, and nutrient exchange was the prime key, this design parameters was chosen. And it was a grid structure, which is amenable for printing using the 3D biome printer that we used. And also in the right panel, we show this ACM structures, ACM of this particular structures. And you can clearly see each, though they have grid structures which open spaces between the grid lines, but also the grids or the lines themselves are very, very porous, with open-ended pores throughout, which allows the cells to take in the drugs and the nutrients which are in the media circulating in the dynamic and the static culture, so that they can be induced and survived. Use this. Also, there is a porosity. In terms of the porosity, it was roughly around 80 to 85% that we have observed, which is very good in terms of maintaining this. So having done this, we moved on to the next one, where we used this, looked at the cellular viability. So as I said, once we create a composite structure, we have to first validate how the cells which are printed along with the bioink, like the primed ADMSCs to the bone and the cartilage, are surviving or not. So this is a gross structure, which where we have given different colors, where the bone is the yellow and the cartilage is the pink color, and the interface in between, to show that it is recapitulated. Also, we looked at the cell survival, where we have looked at on the bone phase and the control phase, where in we have looked at the cell survival, where the green dots are the cells which are stained with live stain, and they are in healthy condition, and they are spread it throughout. That shows the ink carries these cells and they remain viable, and they are growing within the ink. And that was a good sign for us to carry forward the disease induction. And then also in the deep panel, we see the cytokine treated, where if you compare with the left and the right, you see the dimming of the green that shows that once the cytokine is done, there is an effect on the cells, which leading to a lesser of this, and which shows that there are more healthy and viable cells in the healthy construct compared to the disease phenotype, which has been induced by treating with the cytokines. Now, to again further validate, we looked at some of the parameters specifically. Now, here we are looking at the parameters where we are looking at when they are exposed with IL-1 beta and TNF alpha, which is for the osteoarthritic induction. So, following this, we looked at how these are treated and how they express. So, we have found here primarily the sulfated GAG and collagen, which are very important extracellular matrix components of the cartilage formed by the chondrocytes and the bone cells, where we found that ALP is also, we all know, as the hallmark marker that is expressed by the osteoblast cells. And we try to look at this particular extracellular matrices like the sulfated GAG, ALP, right, and the collagen and their content throughout, where initial and the cytokine treatment and then followed up. So the results of our study indicate that we found a consistent increase in sulfated GAG collagen in ALP over a period of 14 days in the healthy construct. So before the induction of the disease, we found these molecules to go up, which is a hallmark effect, which shows that the cells are viable and the cells are growing in number and they're healthy and they are expressing their extracellular matrices as in GAG, collagen and ALP. However, their levels were significantly decreased to up to 2 to 3 fold on day 5 when we induce them with the cytokines as compared to the healthy construct. So as was expected, that when a disease condition is created in the human body as well, so what first primary effect is observed is this extracellular matrices, which I talked about, the GAG, collagen and the ALP levels, they try to go down. And that is what we observed in our healthy models when we induce the disease. And this level where, as I said, we're up to the levels of 2 to 3, which significantly mean that this is an effect of the induction of the disease, which we could recapitulate strongly in the model. This decrease levels were further reversed up to 1.5 fold upon treatment of this celecoxib and rhene. And this is what particularly is
Shyam, have we?
I think he has lost connection.
Okay, let me just call.
Sorry for this interruption, but we'll just start in a couple of minutes.
Yeah, I'll just call him.
No, he's back.
He's back.
Yeah, sorry, there was a intermittent internet connection in the office, I think. When did I lose you? Sorry?
Yes, I think if you just show the slide, then maybe we can just tell you. Yeah, it was just like last 30 seconds or something. So,
this one,
yeah.
This slide itself?
Yes, Dr. Mandal, here.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry for the interruption. Of course, Saturday, so internet
disrupting. Yeah, no, it's completely fine. Yeah, thank you.
Yes. So what I was saying primarily in the last 30 seconds was after we created, we observed the extracellular matrix upregulation when the primary construct was treated with and a normal healthy tissue was created. That means that the cells were viable and they expressed the alkaline phosphatase, meaning the bone cells were growing, sulfated GAG and collagen, which means the chondrocytes and the bone extracellular matrices were created. After that, and we observed up to expression.
We've lost him again, right, Chan?
Yeah. Dr. Mandal, can you hear us?
Okay, let me just call him. Okay, he's trying to connect again. Please bear with us. I think he's having some connection issues and he is trying to connect again.
Yes, is it visible now?
Yes, Dr. Mandal.
Yes, sorry, I came to office hoping that the internet connection would be stronger, but it is acting otherwise.
Yeah, it's okay. I think someone else also has mentioned that in Guwahati there are a few internet issues.
Yeah, recently we are facing this in the late afternoon, a couple of hours. I hope there is no interruptions now. So, to sum up, as I was saying, the extracellular matrix has gone up 2 to 3 fold in this recreated construct as shown in GAG, sulfated GAG, collagen and ALP activity. And further treatment upon treatment with celecoxib and rein, we see this coming down to 1.5 fold, which is a clear evidence that this disease phenotype can be reversed when these molecules are expressed. So moving on, what we did is we looked at this particular inflammatory mediators, which are nothing but the soluble inflammatory mediators, which are involved in the pathogenesis of the osteoarthritis, and where nitric oxide pathway, which includes the iNOS, which is the inducible nitric oxide synthase, and prostacycline pathway, which includes the cyclooxygenase 2, that's the COX-2, prostaglandin E2, and these are known to have long-term implications in osteoarthritis pathogenesis. So we looked at the results shows that upon induction of with cytokines, significantly upregulated both the nitric oxide, which is around 2-fold, and PGE2 up to 3.5-fold. So compared to the healthy constructs that we had, this enhancement clearly shows that that this is induced, and then further this significantly this levels significantly got reduced when we treated them with the drug which is the celecoxib and the rhine. So it clearly gives an evidence to us that by tracking these inflammatory mediators and their levels, that response to the treatment of the cytokines with an upregulation, and upon treatment of the drug molecule, there is downregulation. So this clearly shows that these are very responsive models, and the reported levels are similar to what we find in the literature for the disease phenotype. Now, also ADAMETS, which we have looked at, degrades the aggrecan proteins via the proteolytic degradation. So this has a long-term effect on the structural integrity and the mechanical property. So what means is that imagine in a disease condition, if the osteochondral tissue, we always hear that, or we read that there is a lot of fragmentation that is happening in the chondral region. And that is primarily because of this particular extracellular matrix, the aggrecan getting proteolytically degraded and leading to loosening or mechanical loss and leading to fragmentation. So when we looked at this particular ADAMETS 4 level, we found that a 2.5 fold increase upon cytokine induction, which is further reversed when celecoxib and rhine given up to a level of 1.7 fold. So again, it shows that when induced, this further enhanced proteolytic degradation is observed. However, when drugs are given, which are gold standard molecules, this leads to lowering of this particular proteolytic degradation. So again, shows that these models are very valuable, and it responds to this kind of inflammatory mediators as well. Now, further, what we have looked at is the ECM, in terms of the MMPs also. So the ECM components such as collagen 2 plays a very, very important role in the structural integrity, mechanical properties of osteochondral tissue. And in a OA condition, it is degraded, proteolytically degraded by the various MMPs that are present, right? So we wanted to see how this MMPs behave during drug disease induction and after drug treatment, and whether it recapitulates the standard upregulation and downregulation cycle as in a normal disease model or not. So among MMPs, 113 are the major ones which we looked at and which involved in the collagen 2 degradation. And also we found that MMPs were significantly increased upon treatment with the cytokines, which is a standard observation that in the disease we observe, and we could recapitulate that in the model. Further, with treatment of the celecoxib and the rhine, we found in our model that the cytokine-induced MMPs levels increased, and these further MMPs were as a result of the hypertrophic chondrocytes. So what happens in the osteoarthritic condition is the normal chondrocytic phenotype is converted to a hypertrophic phenotype, right? So this leads to an inflamed kind of an osteoblast in the disease model, and we could kind of recapitulate that further in the model as well. And that clearly shows that the upregulation and downregulation, that this is a very responsive model, which we could create with this particular 3D structure, 3D printed structure that we have done. Further, in the gene level expression, we looked at various anabolic and catabolic genes. So the anabolic genes of cartilage, which includes collagen 2, aggrecan, were significantly found to be upregulated in the healthy constructs. SOX9 shows hyperactivity on day 7, but not on day 14, right? Which is a key early differentiation marker, which is in agreement with our previous reports, which are available in literature. Furthermore, RUNX2 and osteopontin genes were shown to have initial increase expression and were decreased upon the cytokine induction, with no significant increase when treated with the anti-inflammatory drugs. Right. So similarly, we found that bone lesions in osteoarthritis, which is a result of the particular disease, so could which occur.
Yeah, I think he's gone off the grid. So once. Hopefully he'll rejoin soon. Please give us a minute.
In the culture state, but also when this drug treatment was done, they could reverse back as well. So 1 minute on what is required. What I understand is in terms of the regulatory compliances, we have a very strong regulatory compliance in terms of when we deal with animals. But if for in vitro models, I think this is something which needs to be taken care of in the years to come, because there should be standards in place which would has to be validated whenever a disease model is created, because otherwise it will be a batch to batch variation and then may not observe the right results and validate the right molecules if it is a batch to batch variation. So compliances are to be I think drafted and should be in place so that we can have a alternative model which could fast track drug development and be an alternative to the in vivo models currently in place, and so that more number of drug molecules can be created for treatment of diseases. So I will not go through these conclusive slides anyway, but I would surely go through this slide, where I would like to acknowledge the contribution of the entire team here, IIT Guwahati and the funding agencies. And of course, Yugender, he is a PhD student with me, just given his synopsis and moving to US for his postdoc. So this is a work of him, where we could develop this in vitro or through arthritic model for the drug testing evaluation. Some impressive pictures of the campus of IIT Guwahati. So if you are planning to visit this site, you have more reasons to visit now, and we'll be happy to welcome you. And thank you so very much. And I'm sorry for the interruptions, but again, we have to live with it, I think, you know, in an era of online talks. And thank you so very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mandal, for the very interesting talk. And yes, I'm sure everyone has been through all these interruptions, and we are kind of, it's part of life now. So so there are several questions in the chat box, and hopefully we can get through most of them. So what we can do is I can read out the questions to you so that everyone is aware of what the question is, and then we can go through it one by one. So the first question is by Sashwat, I think, and they're asking what was the rationale behind using two different kinds of silk type, and what was the ratio and use of PVP.
So this paper is about to come. We have submitted the revision in a flagship journal, and where all the details would be given anyway. But the reason for these two silk is to have is, as I said, we want a construct where the cells could be made viable and they could proliferate, right? So if you know silk, as I was giving in the introduction slide, one silk has the RGD sequence, which is the non-mulberry wild silk. So when we have this mulberry and the wild mulberry silk together, so they form a very nice network, which is very, very amenable for a printing, viscosity, right? And it also allows a lot of cross-linking to happen, which we have done through the use of some of the cross-linkers, right? So that was the reason we have used these two silk varieties. Of course, I'm not saying this is the only way to create it, but there are different polymers, both synthetic and natural, and one can create, interesting thing in science. One can have better alternatives, better molecules, better, polymers to create this. But we found a lot of sense here using this, an affordable molecule, affordable polymer, which is very, very inexpensive. Because imagine if I'm creating a model which is very expensive and expensive, more expensive than the animal model. So the question is, will the industry would use it? Probably not. So we have to cut down and make it very lucrative for the industry. And also not forget that the cells should be viable and they should be doing what they should be doing for creating a disease model. So there should be a balance. And we found this balance here. And the next is, it is a hydrophilic molecule, PVP. It's a bulking agent that we used to have this amenable viscosity to create this 3D printed structure.
Right. So the next question is by Manoj Kumar, and they're asking, what are the tests done with your bio-ink to show that they are not toxic to your cells of interest? And in addition, can you comment on the importance of rheological studies of bio-ink and 3D printing?
So I think in my slides, I briefly covered that when we showed that the live-based assay. So primarily that was done to show that for a 7-14 days time, the cells are viable and they are proliferating. That clearly shows in one of the assays, of course, in one of the ways to show the components are non-toxic and it allows the cells to proliferate, which is very important. Also, we have tons of literature which we have published ourselves, and the world has published on silk showing that one of the form is already an FDA approved, Mommix Mori silk, which shows that these are potent biopolymers which can be used for different kind of tissue engineering and even for human transplantation. So we should not be having any worry in terms of the cytotoxicity here. Of course, one very important thing one needs to know and understand is the amount of cross-linker you use and the additives. So anything beyond a certain minimum level, if it is enhanced, of course, there will be a lot of cytotoxicity. So people are to, when they're developing their models or the polymer composition, they have to verify all the time. So that is what we have done. And I think your next part of the question was, sorry, I missed it.
The next part was importance of rheological studies of bio-ink and...
Right. So as I said, we use 3D bioprinters. So in 3D bioprinting, two very big challenges come. One is you have to print a construct which would remain freestanding. It will not collapse, because otherwise the minute architecture would all collapse together and you will not get this dimension that you want. So you want it to kind of remain, the lines to remain and not to collapse. And that is what we done through the first cross-linked horseradish peroxidase based cross-linking along with the silk polymers we have done. Second is very important here is the extrusion. Now we are using cells along with the bio-ink. Now we all know cells are very, very sensitive. So if you use too much of pressure to extrude this through the bioprinter through a nozzle, which is 21 or 22 gauge needle, what will happen? The cell membrane will get disturbed and the cells would die. Also, you have to maintain a lot of care on the temperature that you keep. So we try to do at some ambient temperature so that the viability is not affected. And also we took a lot of care in terms of adding certain factors in and around so that the cells remain viable. And also I showed, I think in my results, the thixotropic result, which shows that the bio-ink remains, you know, or maintains its conformity and do not collapse. And that we have done, you know, both rheologically and in terms of the mechanical testing that we have done.
Person is asking, does the scaffold porosity depend on the diameter of the fiber?
So there are two levels of porosity. One is the macro porosity, which is given by the grid structure. So it is line within line. So whatever the gaps you have between the lines is the macro structure. Macro porosity, which is like very big, right? And that allows the nutrient exchange and media perfusion to happen. Another porosity is within the line. So each line, because each line is the bioink which carries the cell, and the cell needs to gather this nutrient from the outside. So in my SEM images, I showed this are very super porous structure up to the level of 83%, and that allows the nutrients to kind of move in and move out, and that allows it to survive.
Okay. So Rishabh Diosingh is asking, does the bioink also contain the biological cues for differentiation into different cell types? If not, then how is the differentiation controlled?
So what I already explained, that we use MSCs and we kind of pre-differentiate them, you know, to using the known factors, both for oestrogenic and chondrogenic, before we use in the bioink. One we prime them in those direction, they tend to move in those directions. So once we prime, and then we use in the bioink, and that takes care of. And then in the media, we use a combination of osteochondral and osteochondral combination where bone and cartilage factors are given so that they maintain.
So one person is asking, do you need ethical approval to extract silk fibroin from silkworm?
Not really. So that is, of course, these are living system, but because they come in the category of insects, and you know, so as of now, the regulations doesn't inhibit extraction. But again, there are two modes, just for the information, that one is from the cocoon. So if we are using silk for textile, for saris or any kind of apparel also, what it is done is the cocoons, which is the silk worm spins around itself when there is a metamorphosis happening to the moth. So they are extracted from the cocoon. So one can get it from the cocoon and dissolve, there are protocols available, or one can get it from the worm itself, or the wild variety. We use both of them.
So next question is from Hassan. They're asking, how do we decide the concentration and time of cytokine induction?
So this for us, it was a trial and error, as I said. So what we did was we looked at different concentrations, and also we looked at different time points, and we monitored them through the gene level and the protein level, and that is how we decided. Also, what helped us is, in terms of the literature, in terms of defining and determining what levels we want. So that is how any progress, research progress, has to be done. It may not be readily available, and we have to rely on the information that is available with us, and then plan so that we kind of define those which is needed for the purpose.
Next is Queenie Dasgupta is asking, is there a way to generate spontaneous arthritis in this model by other degeneration inducing factors instead of adding pro-inflammatory cytokines to mimic an inflammation response? And also, does the addition of this cytokine lead to a progressive arthritis, or does it begin to resolve with time?
Yes, so as I said, the main reason for me to explain the different phases or stages was because so we have to understand that we are trying to recreate a disease which is in a human system, and we are trying to recapitulate in a petri dish, right? Now we may have different, it will be wrong to say that, you know, there are more than one ways and factors which leads to this particular disease, right? But to our understanding, what has been primarily looked at is this particular cytokines, which probably is setting up the tone and leading to the progression of the disease, right? And why we wanted to choose something which is available in literature, because at the end of the day, we have to justify and assess different parameters when we are testing the drug, because the final aim is to create a disease model phenotype which is matching the disease phenotype in the humans. And the primary aim is when a drug molecule, this is these two as known standard drug molecules, right? But if somebody is developing a new drug molecule, then we have to use that, and we have to have certain known parameters to say whether it is working and not working, right? So there are certain limitations currently to look into certain parameters based on literature, but of course, sky is the limit, and probably these models would help us to better understand and find out more ways. So what I would appreciate the question, because the other study can be not only for drug development, but to understand how this disease progresses and what factors disease progresses. So one can use this instead of creating a disease model, one can use this as a native model and try to create diseases. So that can be another use of it.
Next question is by Dr. Ashwini, who's asking, which silk out of Bombyx mori and Antheria is better to fabricate these tissue models for disease? Secondly, which silk is better in terms of possible grafting purpose?
So from our experience, my experience of 10 years here as a faculty and probably 18 plus years since I started my PhD. So it was on silk, my postdoc was on silk and my lab runs on silk. So you can imagine from 2005 to 2021, I'm working on silk. So my little experience says that it all depends on the purpose. So one variety doesn't have the RGD sequence and the other variety has the RGD sequence, right? But the variety which doesn't have the RGD sequence, which is the Bombyx mori, people have done chemistry and they have added these RGD sequences through synthesis or through combination through chemistry methods. Modes, right? So one can kind of couple with the functional groups and you can have RGDs and you can make them amenable for the cells. But also there are differences, for example, mechanical properties. So if you are trying to make robust structures, then wild silk is good because of the resilience and the sequence that leads to that resilience compared to the Bombyx mori, which is already known. Also the degradability. So the time of degradation varies. The response to cells varies. So it all depends, what you are trying to make at the end of the day. And the components are to be chosen accordingly.
So another question is where the person is asking if you can kindly highlight the design considerations that could be incorporated in future iterations, such as addition of vasculature to more faithfully recapture the pathophysiology of the osteochondral zone.
Right. Now, vasculature is a very important parameter in all kind of tissues that we are developing. So there is a concept of inducing angiogenic condition so that this blood vessels go hand in hand when the tissue is growing, being grown. Otherwise, the tissue would not survive, because the nutrient and exchange to happen, it has to happen along with the tissue. Now, the good thing about this is because where we all know that the chondrocytic region or the chondrous region is avascular, a major portion of it, right? It doesn't have the blood vessels. So, but the bone has. So, what one can look at is how one can kind of have angiogenic activity and develop blood vessels into this by using endothelial cells or some mechanism, or maybe using growth factors. But here in this, probably it is may not be needed. It will be too early to say that. But to my understanding, it may not be required, because this is a disease phenotype which is created for drug toxicity assessment and also drug discovery. So we may not need the actual recapitulation of vasculature, but as long as we can recapitulate the disease phenotype.
Right. So maybe we can take one last question where person is asking, can we use macrophage cells after inducing it instead of cytokines, as in tissues, these cells play a major role in inflammation?
Yes, surely one can. Surely one can. People have shown that they can use cells, because at the end of the day, the cytokines originate from the cells itself, right? And the macrophages are known to, or the immune cells known to play a big role in terms of induction. So instead of using the molecules, we can use cells, which is primarily happening in the body, and trigger them to release. But again, the problem probably would be that how much of those triggers one can create, because it has to have a certain known level. So because if you are recapitulating a disease model, and if there is batch-to-batch variation because of the cellular expression of those macrophages or induction, then you will have batch-to-batch variation in the disease phenotype level that you are creating, which would not be the ideal way. So that is why probably using known molecules, a certain desired concentration is the best possible way, but both are doable.
Right. Just end with this last comment, which is a question, but Ruban Venish, they're asking, is it possible to collaborate for relevant work with your lab?
Yeah, sure. Yes, as I was showing, you know, in my previous slide, we believe in collaboration, and we already have tons of collaboration which are complementary. So we learn, we believe in learning from the other side, which they are expert in, and we believe in sharing, you know, what we have learned to the other side, so that the goal is fulfilled, faster and more realistically. When, and then also when more experts join hands, I think it is better for the outcome.
Right. So I think in terms of questions, we'll kind of end here because of time. And thanks a lot, Dr. Mandal, for this amazing presentation. As you mentioned, I think the critical need of the hour is we need to, you know, have standardized guidelines for each of the protocols to kind of reduce the variations or heterogeneities, which is going to be key for a more broader adoption of this methodology. So with this,
some question, Surat Adi, some Hassan is trying to ask some question. Yes, yeah.
Yes, please. Yeah, please go ahead. Hassan,
I think this question is already there. Can we use macrophage cells after inducing?
I think after this, I think he or she has written.
Yeah.
Okay, so that person is asking, can we recapitulate CHIKV induced arthritis? I'm not sure what that is.
So, as I said here, it is only the first level of osteoarthritis that we, you know, have induced here, which is the early stage. But again, there are various stages, and one should not claim that one model would fit everything, because there are different treatment modalities and there are different pathways which play in each of the stages. So whatever is the disease condition, whether it is OA model or any of the disease models, we have to understand whether it is stage specific and what plays a role in creating that stage. And that only once it is recapitulated in a hierarchy.
Yeah, I think his perspective is towards chikungunya and other induced models. I think the answer is aptly implied for that. So, I mean, just before we close, I know Dr. Biman very well, who is actually having a lot of translational understanding of these kind of scaffolding and, you know, grafting models, 3D printed models, etc. So, yeah, he's already kind of, you know, reaching to the productization level, I guess. And just to motivate the youngsters here, and I guess definitely a few startups also here, what are the, you know, kind of, you know, recent trends to address, probably, you know, to imply these kind of models that can be used in the healthcare systems, you know, because your science, basis is very much important when you are actually trying to work on some kind of models like this. But however, what are the more opportunities, if you can put some light, maybe that will be wonderful for the benefit of students here.
Ramji, I think we have lost Dr.
Biman. Dr. Biman again? Okay.
Yeah, because...
I think we lost him.
I think he's lost his connection again.
Okay, no problem. I think he answered a lot of questions.
Yes.
Probably covered most of the things. Yeah, that's great. So...
Yeah.
I think, Shyam, maybe we can just end it. Just one more point before Shyam closes the session. We are also, the center, we are also planning to start a newsletter in which we'll be covering all the human relevant information in India and also abroad. And hopefully that newsletter will be coming out in the coming few weeks. And we hope that you all also register to have a look at all the latest developments that are happening in this field, both in India and globally. So with that, I would ask Shyam to close the session.
Yeah, thank you all for your time in attending this session. Even though there were a few glitches, I think we were successful in having Dr. Biman's presentation and also taking questions and getting them answered by him. So as already mentioned, we will be coming out with a newsletter. So we'll also be sending emails to people, so if they're interested, they can subscribe to the newsletter and then we could send them across the newsletter. And also the recording of this video would be uploaded on YouTube and will also be shared with everyone who have registered. And also please, if possible, then you can send this across to people who might be interested. And also we also thank Dr. Kamal Vishnu for attending this webinar. Apart from it, also a few other faculties from CCMB have also attended, and also other professors from other institutes have also attended this webinar. We heartfully thank them and would like to see you all in the future upcoming webinars from this center. And once again, thank you for your time and hope to see you all in the upcoming webinars. Thank you all. Surat, is there anything else that you want to add?
No, that's it, Shyam. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, guys.